It's a long ways down, but even longer coming back up. Hi. Today's South Dakota adventure takes us to the Straddle Bowl in the Black Hills. We're going to learn about firsts today. We all like to be first. First in a race, first in line. Here at the Straddle Bowl back in 1935, a stratosphere balloon named Explorer 2 was a first and set a world record altitude of 72,395 feet, and that was a first. Charles Lindbergh was first to cross the Atlantic in a solo plane west to east, and Alan Shepard was the first American in space, and Neil Armstrong was the first man to step on the moon. But who were the first people to come to the New World, and who were the first people in South Dakota? Well, we'll learn about the first people today, and we'll want to learn about the answers to these questions. How did these people find the Great Plains? Had they always been here? What did they believe? And what evidence proves their existence? We all know the story of Christopher Columbus, how he set out to prove the world was round and find an all-water route to India. About 500 years ago, he landed in some islands off the coast of North America, and he writes in his journal of the first people he saw.
Most of them were young and of goodly height. Their hair was straight and thick, very black and short. They were of medium build, well-shaped and solid, of an olive color. They are hopelessly timid, but after they lost their fear, they are so friendly and so generous with all that they have. They never say no when asked for anything they want. They all believe that the power and the good are in the sky. And they firmly believe that I, these ships and the men, came from that sky.
Because Columbus believed he had reached India by sailing west, he called these people Indians. Although Columbus was mistaken, Native Americans are still called Indians by many people today. As far as we know today, the people we still call Indians were the first people here. But how did they get here? Some old Indians answer that question by saying, we were always here. One legend tells that Indian people are descended of the coyote. The Sisseton Sioux describe the beginnings of Native Americans in another way. After the creation of the world, Wahantanka, the Holy One, grew uneasy and restless as he walked about in the Black Hills. He had no one to love. No one could give him love. From the wind and Mother Earth came man, son of Earth and grandson of the Holy One. Wahantanka was no longer lonely. Scientists, too, are interested in knowing about the beginnings of human beings. Such a scientist is called an anthropologist. The beginning of the word, anthrope, means a human being. If we add logi, which means a science of or a study of, we have the word anthropology. Therefore, the whole word means a study of human beings, where they lived, how they lived, and differences among races. If we drop the Y and add IST, we have a word that means one who specializes in the study of human beings. Anthropologists tell us the first people in the New World didn't necessarily have their beginnings in North and South America. The first people that we call Native Americans might have found their way to the New World thousands and thousands of years ago. But where did they come from? One of the common beliefs is that the first people came from Asia. They came across the Bering Strait. Now, a strait is a narrow passageway connecting two large bodies of water. The Bering Strait was dry when the first animals and people wandered into the New World. Other anthropologists explain that the land between Asia and Alaska was more than 1,000 miles across from north to south. This large mass of land was called Beringia. Scientists say that animals such as the mammoth, the caribou and the bison, the muskox and deer crossed Beringia into North America, and the hunters followed. The third group of anthropologists say it's possible the first people came from islands in the Pacific Ocean. These first people who came to North America did not look like people from other races. They had coppery skin, dark eyes, straight black hair, and wide cheekbones. As anthropologists learn more and more about the first Americans, we know they were a thinking people with a spoken language. The tools they had were more than simple ones. Because scientists do not agree upon when the first people wandered into the New World, we cannot be exact. Some say the first people came as early as 30,000 years ago. Others say only 10,000 years ago. Animal bones and a tool called a tooth scraper are evidence that both man and animals were in the Yukon Territory in Canada 25,000 years ago. Other human bones and tools have been discovered in the United States. Scientists who search for the remains of ancient or first people and how they lived are called archaeologists. The word grows like anthropologist. The discoveries of both anthropologists and archaeologists can help us better understand the first people. We can learn a lot by examining the tools, bones, and cooking vessels of these people. Any evidence that will help us learn the truth. Daryl Fulmer is the head archaeologist here at the Mitchell Prehistoric Indian Village. Daryl, how do you learn about people by digging in the ground?
Well, whenever people live in an area for any period of time, they make changes in their environment. They make things, they dig holes, they change the chemistry of the soil. And if those changes are able to last over a period of time, someone later can look at them and figure out what activities they actually carried out there. So that's basically what we do as we are trying to discover more about these prehistoric people where there are no written records.
Over 1,000 years ago, about 1,200 people lived here near Lake Mitchell. Daryl, you've got a grid system laid out here over a trench. What are you learning about the people that once lived here?
We're learning the sort of village they had, the arrangement of the houses in the village. We're learning how they defended themselves with fortification works. What sorts of food they had, what kinds of animals they killed. These were hunting people, they were also farming people. We're learning the kinds of crops they grew, and we're learning much about the sort of tools that they had in order to carry out their living pattern.
Well, behind us, Daryl, are cross hatchings and a trench and some of the archaeological digging that you've been doing. What are you finding out about the people that lived here?
We're using that cross-hatching, the grid, to map in things that we locate, things such as posts. For example, these people lived in houses about 20 feet wide and 40 feet long. They used lots of posts to support the walls and the roof, and then they covered the whole thing with willow mat and grass thatch, and maybe with dirt and sod. We can find those holes in the ground now 900 or 1,000 years since the site was inhabited. So we can get a pretty good idea of their architecture. Also, some of the features inside the house, things like pits that were dug in the floor, show us the kinds of animals and plants they used for food. For example, there's a trash pit in the floor of the house full of bone, probably mostly a buffalo bone. It also has some clam shells in it. We know these people ate lots of buffalo, and they collected clams for food. Also, although it's a little harder to visualize because of the fact that we're looking at just a tiny section of it, there is a wall showing in the house, and the clue that we have there is the different colors of soil located in our excavation wall. So we have here a unit, one house floor, and in fact the village itself may have had 60 to 70 houses, each having 10 to 20 people in it. So we really had a rather large population of people living here before history and prehistory.
Archaeologists have been very busy in South Dakota, perhaps very near your home. They're curious about the first people who lived here. Nearly 40 years ago, archaeologists uncovered evidence in the very southwestern corner of South Dakota in Fall River County. an Indian campsite was there nearly 7,000 years ago. We know wandering tribes were in the Black Hills about 1,000 years ago. We also know that more than 1,000 years ago, people known as mound builders lived along the Big Sioux River, Big Stone Lake, and other streams and bodies of water. These people were chiefly hunters, but they built mounds to bury their dead. These people seem to have disappeared from South Dakota more than 1,000 years ago. About 600 to 700 years ago, Indian people who liked to live on the land rather than move about to hunt their food moved to South Dakota from Minnesota. Another tribe moved north from Kansas and Nebraska to live along the Missouri River. These people were the Arikaraw, usually called Rees. Because many of the early people in our state lived along the Missouri River, the archaeologists had many sites, or digs, before the dams were built. The water behind the dams would have risen higher and higher, destroying more evidence. The Rosa site in Potter County was investigated before the waters filled the Owyhee Reservoir. Archaeologists found many remains of the Indian way of life between 1675 and 1740, nearly 300 years ago. If you would like to know more about what archaeologists have found in our state, librarians can help you. Archaeologists often work with universities and the government. Ask your teacher to help you get the reports. Besides the Rosa site, you can read about the Owyhee site and the Spotted Bear site near Pier. You can find out more about the Gavin's Point area near Lewis and Clark Lake. Perhaps you'd like to find out more about the Split Rock Creek mounds near Brandon or those near Mitchell. We need the help of many scientists to continue to find the truth about the first people who came to the New World, the United States, and South Dakota. We do now believe the first people may have come from Asia. They probably crossed the Bering Strait. Some scientists believe the first people may have come from the Pacific, crossing the ocean to our western coast. As scientists, anthropologists, and archaeologists learn more about the first people, then we'll learn more from them and maybe answer the riddle of who was first.